I have brand new Joggles products to tell you about, ones that I've had in development for a while and am really excited about. Tunnel Books. Made from sturdy chipboard, the style you see here measures 6 inches by 6 inches and features a circular tunnel. In today's video, I'll show you how I've created this autumn and Halloween themed version. I'll explain how to base coat the pages, apply color to the backgrounds, and talk about the images on the collage sheets. At the end, I'll show you two other styles of tunnel books that are also debuting today. When you take your tunnel book out of the package, you're going to have 8 pages. You'll have a front and back cover, and then you're going to have the inner pages that make the tunnel. They'll be held together with small book rings like this. For now, they don't need to be on here, so I've taken them off. Just easy, you open them and slip them off. Because this is chipboard, obviously anything you put on here, if you put color on, is going to be influenced by the color of the chipboard. So to get away from that, I've base coated mine with white. And I've chosen to use Dilutions White Linen, and you might be wondering why. Well, I don't want gesso because gesso has tooth, and I don't want tooth. I just want coverage at this point so I don't see the color of the chipboard. The Dilutions paint is magical. When you spritz over it, nothing is going to bead up. I mean, typically if you're working with an acrylic paint, a water-based paint, and you spritz something over the top, it's going to bead up. But as you can see here, that's not the case at all. So what you'll do, and I'm just going to quickly show you on the cover, I'm going to use one of the mini ink blending tools and the white paint, and I want to get a coat on here. Now, ultimately, I'm probably going to want to get 2 to 3 really thin, really light coats on here. I like this process using the mini ink blending tool because it's going to allow me to get coverage, but I'm not going to see brush strokes. I'm not going to see any variations in depth of color. I'm just going to apply kind of in a circular motion like this. Actually, you know what? You're going to want to do the edges first. I only ever really put one coat on the edges, and I just kind of tap it along like this, get all the way around. You can kind of brush it along like this just so that it's nice and even. Alright, and then if you look in the back, you might see you have a little bit of a ridge of paint just from tapping it, so you'll want to come in and just wipe that off so that it's nice and smooth. Now you can come back kind of with this circular motion, and if you're light-handed about how you do this, you don't want to put too much paint on at once, you'll find that you get a nice even coat so that you don't see any marks in the paint, and you just kind of get a smooth white coverage, which is exactly what I'm looking for when I do this. You can see it goes along quickly. Now when I'm working on a book like this, I'm going to assembly line it. I'm going to do the fronts of all 8 pages, then I'm going to let them dry and do another coat, and then I'm going to do the backs of all 8 pages. I'm going to do that however many times I think I need to until I've got coverage on there that I'm satisfied with. But you can see that this is not difficult at all. Bam, there's one done. Once all the sides are done and everything is good and dry, the next step is going to be to add another kind of paint. So this, you can see that there's a little bit of pattern on here, and you can definitely see that it's metallic. This is the Maya Gold color that's named Bronze, and I'm going to apply it with, well, I'm going to apply it with this little foam roller. These are made by Artsy, which is a division of Momenta. They come in a package like this. They have one that's about this wide, but because I've got these openings cut here, I think that this smaller one works the best. So I'm going to take the cover off my Maya Gold. Now I want really light coverage. I don't want heavy blobs. So I'm going to use a palette knife, and I'm going to put a little bit of this out, kind of like this, and I'm going to very lightly roll this through it so that I just get some very spotty coverage, and then it's just a matter of applying the paint. Now you can apply it heavier than I am if you want. It's really just a matter of choice. I would also assembly line this process. I would do this once I had all of the cover, all of the pages rather, covered with that layer of white paint. Now it doesn't have to be even all the way around, but once you get this done, now I'm going to kind of skip the drying process here so that I can just show you the next step, but ideally you're going to let this dry before you come back with the Lindy's. I have 3 colors of Lindy's Stamp Gang. I have, Lindy's Stamp Gang Starburst Sprays. Cocklebell's Coral, Grab-A-Guy Gold, and this is Canna Lily Burnt Orange. Now I will tell you, my sprayer is clogged here, because probably because I didn't clean it when I put it away the last time. So I'm going to work around that. What I'm going to do is just lightly mist a little bit of everything. Now these tend to spit, which I love because I like the texture I'm getting with those dots. How much of any of these colors you put on is entirely up to you. You can go for heavier coverage if you want. Actually, you know what? I didn't shake the canna lily, so let me just remember to come in. You should shake all of these. I had shaken the Grab-A-Guy Gold. Since this is clogged, I'm just substituting this process where I just use the spray pickup tube and I can put some splotches on like that. From here, it's just a matter of letting it dry. And then once it's dry, you can start to, let me just bring this in. You can see that I've got, I don't want to get color where it doesn't belong. You can see that I've got some pieces cut out from the collage sheets. And now it's a matter of thinking about placement and doing all of that planning. There's a lot of cutting and planning that goes on before you actually start adhering things in place. And I want to talk about images. I want to talk about the mirror image of images so that when you put something like this and it overhangs one of the openings, when you turn it over, it's going to be important that you don't see just plain white here. I'm going to show you how you can use the mirror image, put it on here, and you'll get a piece that looks like this on this side. When I began laying out the images on the various pages in the book, I actually began with the inside of the back cover, and let me tip this just a second. If you look, this is the inside of the back cover right here. Here are the pages with the successively larger or smaller openings depending on which direction you're beginning with. And I knew I wanted this mouse peeking out of the hole in the pumpkin. I also knew that I didn't want to put anything else. I didn't want to overlap the openings on any of the subsequent pages or the pages that come before, actually, so that they would cover up the mouse. I wanted to keep all of that in mind. I also wanted to keep in mind the fact that I didn't want so much stuff hanging out here that it got to be too busy and I didn't like the way, the overall effect. And with that in mind, these pumpkins right here, these little ones on the front here that are hanging over the opening, I may actually trim them back even. I haven't really decided yet. I'll kind of play with that as I go along. But you always have the option to not engage in this process of overlapping the opening and then putting the mirror image on the back side. Now, having said all that, I'm working with a couple of collage sheets full of images and another one that has fall and autumn sayings on it. So I'm going to pick everything up here. And here is the last page. Now this is kind of my thinking about what the layout should be. I like the placement here. I've put another pumpkin with it, and then I've taken one of the quotes and cut it up. I will tell you that I have photographed all of these pages. As I lay them out, and I think I've settled on what I want a page to look like in terms of the arrangement of the images and the text, I use my phone and I take a photo. You will forget. There are 8 pages, and it's unlikely you're going to remember the exact placement. So save yourself the aggravation and just go ahead and photograph them. So on this last page, now all I can do is take everything else out of here. On this last page, I started by placing the first pumpkin with the little mouse peering out of the hole in such a way that I thought that it lined up, and eventually I settled on a spot where it did. From here, it's just a question of building the subsequent pages with images that you like and an arrangement that you like with text that you like if you choose to do that. That's really all there is to this. It's just laying the book out, being satisfied with everything, and then starting to adhere things in place. But let's talk for a second. Let's see, I'm looking for a pumpkin. Well, let me find one where I can actually find the pumpkin that I'm looking for. So let me come in here. You know what, before I do that, let's talk for a second about the edges of the pages and the edges of, let me grab a page here, and the edges of the circles. So here's a page that's had a base coat of white put on it, it's had some of the Maya Gold bronze put on it, and it's obviously had the Lindy's spritzed. And when you look at this, you can see that I've come in here and I've actually edged this. So this is an old beat-up Krylon leafing pen where the tip is all mushed down and it's getting difficult to actually get color to come out. But what I'm going to do is get the color flowing on this, and then I'm going to edge the pages with gold. I just think it provides a little bit more finished look. And if some of it kind of slips over here to the front, kind of like that did, I don't mind at all. And in fact, sometimes I want to do that deliberately so that I get a little bit of texture and pattern on the front. We'll have the leafing pens for anybody that doesn't have one. But this is kind of the process. I'm also going to do the inside of the circle just to kind of finish it off as well. I'll do this to all of the pages. I'm not going to bother with these. The binding rings will be in there, and I'm not going to worry about that. But I think that it adds a nice touch. So with that said, let me just pick this up from the surface so I don't set anything in it. And let's talk about the mirror images. So let me grab a page where I have the stuff handy. Let's slide this out of the way. So here's a page. Now I will admit that the cutting on some of this is finicky and persnickety, and it's going to take some time, but I think that the detail and the effect is well worth the effort. So having said that, you can choose to cut around all of these little elements like I have here, or you can choose to leave the background in place. Sit in front of the TV at night, pretend you're watching, and then you can cut all this stuff out. Yes, it's persnickety, I get that, but I think the effect is so much nicer. So let's remove everything else just for 1 second and look at this branch of these little berries as it kind of overhangs the opening. This is the version of that image that faces one way, and if you look at this, this is the version that faces the other. So when I flip this over and I lay this on here, now these are very thin in spots, so it's a little bit floppy, but as I lay this on here, I just want to kind of line it up. And here's where tweezers come in handy. I find this is much easier to do with tweezers. So I'm just going to come in. This is actually easier to do as you glue it. But what you're going to do, my goodness, I'm all thumbs here. What you're going to do is line this up. Now this will bend back. Again, everything is thin. You're going to line these up in such a way, and I'm going to exaggerate this now so I can get this done. You're going to line these up in such a way that these overlap, and when you turn this over, you're going to see the same thing on one side as you do on the other. Let me glue this up and I'll come back and I'll show you, because obviously I'm all fumbly here and it's a little harder to talk about and do than it is to simply do and then show you the end result. Well, I changed my mind and I decided it probably would be practical if I showed you how to do this. So I have this little branch placed the way that I want it, but I'm not going to glue the whole thing down initially. Instead, what I'm going to do is put just a little bit of glue here. I want to hold that section in place. That's going to give me the opportunity to work with this and not have the darn thing continue to slide all over the place. But that's the only part of this I'm going to glue initially. This is the Scotch Quick Dry Tacky Glue. This is one of our fine line applicator tips. For this particular bottle, you need a 20/410, which means the 20 will fit the neck opening. When you look, this is only half an inch. And then in terms of the gauge size of the needle tip, a 15 or 16 will be good. I've got an 18 on here, but it does require some more hand strength to actually squeeze this out. All right, so now that I've got this in place, what I want to do is flip it over and bring in the mirror image piece. Now the collage sheets, as I've set them up, will all be mirror imaged. Well, I take that back. Most of the elements will be mirror imaged, so you have the opportunity to overlap your openings like this and then either use by using the mirror image, sorry, brain cramp there for a second, or you can simply use them singly if you want to lay your book out a little bit differently. Now I can guarantee you that I have not cut these out identically, but they're going to be reasonably close, and once everything is dry, I can come back and I can do a little bit of trimming. So I'm going to, well, that was too much glue, so let me spread it around. What I'm going to do is get some glue on here, and actually the more I think about this, I need to come over here and put a little bit of glue on this bit right here that's going to overhang, or I won't be able to get back to it, and a tiny bit on the stem. All right, so now that's in place. This is kind of feeling the process out as I go along. All right, so with that in place, what I'm going to do is bring in the other piece that goes on the back, and I'm going to overlap the pieces so that they match up. And I'm going to come in here with tweezers, and I'm going to kind of press this down so that these pieces stick together. In retrospect, I probably should not have had this overlapping so little, but I will fix it after the fact. So now what I've got are these pieces so that the front and the back is more or less lined up. Again, I'm going to fix that one. I'm going to trim that right there. I'm not particularly happy with that expanse of white space, but that's a fixer-upper after this is done. From here, it's just a matter of adhering the rest of this and putting this back in place, because obviously, again, it's twisted a little bit. Putting this in place and putting it down, and then I can do the same thing with the pumpkin which belongs over here, and I'm going to go back and look at the photo on my phone to make certain that I've placed it exactly. Again, I have a mirror image. Now, would you prefer to have, instead of the mouse climbing out facing the inside of the page, would you prefer to have it the other way? You certainly can do that. Mirror image is a mirror image. It doesn't matter which one you put on the front. When you flip this over and put it on the back, it's still going to match up. So let me just kind of show you what I mean. So you can see, well, everything is crooked. You can see that these will line up just the same way once I take a little bit more care. Let me get my big old hand out of there. Once I take a little bit more care and get everything aligned. So that's the process. It's going to be get everything on there, photograph it so you don't forget the layout, and then start to glue them all up. Once that's done, and before that I want to edge all the pages obviously, but once that's done, the book is essentially finished. So let me get all this done, and then I'll come back and I'll flip through the pages so you can see what they look like. With my book complete, I want to finish up with a few final thoughts. I want to show you the pages, and then there's a couple other things I want to show you. There'll be two other styles of tunnel books that debut at the same time that this one does, and I'm going to give you a preview of those too. The first final thought is that the better the job that you do cutting the elements out, the happier you're going to be. That means you need to take your time. I used 4-inch embroidery scissors in some cases, and I also used, this is the OmniGrid cutting station, and this is kind of a takeoff on an X-Acto knife. It's just a bladed knife that I can cut really fine things with. When you start to talk about the inner part of this loop, or even around the tails, or any of these other really finely detailed areas, when you're cutting out all those little pieces, sometimes the X-Acto knife is going to be easier, and I would just caution you to take your time. You want to be aware of where that knife point is versus where your fingers are, but I think you're going to get better results if you use the blade in some cases. I would also suggest that you test fit pieces before you commit anything with glue. What I mean by that is, and you saw a little bit of this earlier, I would line these up, be satisfied that everything is aligned the way that I want and that I'm doing some matchy-matchy things that are making me happy before I commit anything with glue. Now, having said that, you can trim after the fact. I'm not actually going to trim anything, but let's say, for example, that there was something hanging off of this leaf that I'm not really thrilled with, and there is one little spot right there because, of course, I just can't leave well enough alone. So it is far easier for me to do this with a blade, to just come in and nip that off like that and round that leaf a little bit, than it's ever going to be for me to do this with scissors. So be willing to use a blade and a cutting surface like this. When you start to look at how you overlap pieces, now I mentioned this earlier, you can see that I've got this overlap here, but I don't have anything matching on the back, and that was deliberate. This is pretty small, and there's quite a lot that's already hanging out into the openings, and I'll show you what I mean in a second. So I'm going to trim this, and I'm going to use the process that I more or less just showed you. I'm going to use the edge of the book, excuse me, the edge of the circle that's cut here as a guide, and I'm just going to very carefully, taking my time, go along the edge here and cut these pumpkins off so that they're even with the circle. Now, if I've cut a little bit too much out, if I've nipped some of the inside of this circle, I can come back with the Krylon metallic pen, and I can fix anything in here, but that actually looks pretty good. I got one little funky piece there, but I'll deal with that after the fact. So when we talk about the way that this tunnel book looks, let me bring all the pages in, let me line them back up. So this is the outside of my front cover. Now, every page doesn't have some sort of a quote on it, but every page has something on it, except for maybe one right now that I haven't completely finished, but I have enough imagery to do that. So this is the front cover, and then when you look inside, this is what you see when you look down to that image that I so carefully centered or placed on that back page. And going back to the pumpkins, this is upside down, going back to the pumpkins, and this page goes like this, you can see why having them cut off here, I think, makes more sense than having them extend into the opening in the tunnel. I just think it was a little bit too busy, and I think that this looks better. Obviously, you can do whatever you like. But as you start to open these pages one at a time, you can see the imagery. Let's slide this a little bit. You can see the imagery that's on the back of the pages. And as I said, there is room to do a little bit more if I choose to. I'm going to photograph the fronts and backs of all of these pages, and I'll post them on the blog with the video and the supplies, so that if you want to grab one of these, I'm going to kit this up, you can certainly do that. But this was a really fun project, a really rewarding project, and with the autumn not that far away and Halloween certainly not that far away, I think that it's a really nice thing to work on, to get into the fall spirit, or if you need a gift for somebody, I think that giving them the kit and a link to the video is a nice gift for anyone who's creative, or you can certainly make it for them. So quickly, I do want to show you these other two tunnel books. This is going to be the exact same as what you just saw. It's 6x6 with the three holes in it, except that the tunnel is made of squares. So you get a very different look this way. And then, whoops, the last one is a rectangle. This is going to measure 9 inches tall by 6 inches wide. And when you open it, you can see the tunnel is slightly different. The height of the openings is all the same, but then they're going to gradually decrease as you get to the back. So if you have an image or something that's long and narrow that you can center on the back, then you can work your way inward from there. So to start with, we'll have these three tunnel books. As I said, I will kit this up with the collage sheets that you need, the images and the text quotes, and it'll be good to go. It'll have book rings in it too. I hope you take a chance on this project. I think that it's very easy to do. Admittedly, there's a lot of cutting out, but once you get that all done, then the fun part happens when you can start to arrange all the images on the page.